Hi, I'm Jack Barnes, President and CEO of People's United Bank. I'm here on Audubon Street in New Haven, a vibrant cultural center. People's United Bank is proud to support the communities where we live and work. That's why we're supporting CPTV and the many Connecticut cultural treasures they will be featuring over the coming months. Look for stories each week featuring a cultural treasure in your neighborhood.
The arts can inspire us to excel in non-artistic endeavors. It's true. For students, studies have shown that involvement in the arts can lead to higher academic achievement, better SAT scores, and have a positive impact on leadership skills. When you study music and theater, it's proven you do better in math and reading. Hi, I'm Edward Zbicki. And it's pretty clear that the arts are not only creative treasures, but powerful tools for learning, growth, and better health. On today's episode, we'll tour the Yale University Art Gallery, where learning and education is at the core of its mission. We'll visit a special kind of museum devoted to aviation and the magic of flight. We'll get hands-on at the Yale Peabody Museum of Natural History. We'll also meet Prudence Crandall, whose commitment to education in the face of racism is an inspiring Connecticut story. And we'll see how movies, performance, and community involvement work together in New London. In the early years of motion pictures, when silent films and vaudeville coexisted, the Movie Palace energized our nation.
These beautiful places were meant to transport the richest and poorest of people to places that only their imagination could take them.
And in New London, at a theater built in 1926 and named after businessman Walter Gard, a community of immigrants not only came together to dream.
A lot of people didn't speak English, so when they were looking at the silent films, they learned about how to speak, and they saw how people dressed. So popular culture really was created in these places.
Today, the Gard Arts Center offers great performances, cultural and social enrichment, and relevant arts education to New London and its region.
When people come to this theater, yes, they come to witness something wonderful on stage, whether it's live or on film, but they also come to be with each other.
Since 1985, when this iconic theater reinvented itself as a nonprofit, it has found the pulse of its community.
We look at different types of programming so that we can appeal to every aspect of the community. But as well, you know what? It's an economic driver.
It's a 40-foot wide proscenium.
Under the leadership of Executive Director Steve Siegel, with the state's help and many community partners, the Gard raised over $11 million to restore and renovate.
Getting you here to the most beautiful theater in the world.
It could have ended up as a parking lot. And what we were able to do with the help of the region was to bring that beauty right into focus.
5, 6, 7, 8!
For over 8 decades, the Gard has helped create and define American pop culture.
As a performing arts center, we do touring Broadway. We have all kinds of family events and contemporary music and jazz, opera.
And in 1987, it brought classical performance to its audiences with the Eastern Connecticut Symphony Orchestra. Film continues to bring audiences together in this historic theater. The annual Manhattan Shorts Film Festival is just one of many unique movie screenings hosted at the Gard. The theater has also announced a new era of digital film projection.
You've never seen a film until you've seen a film in this building. When those lights go down, you're seeing the films the way they really were meant to be seen.
The theater continues to produce special events and brings celebrities and speakers to New London.
We also do these community partnerships that end up being quite unique.
This recent collaboration with Allison Chase Dance grew into a residency to test new work on New London audiences.
They create a piece that they've been workshopping in a small studio in New York.
It was such an enlightening experience for me. The talent of the dancers, the athleticism, it was really rewarding, and I felt like it had benefited me a very great deal.
With a mission deeply committed to its community and its future, there's always an emphasis on youth, including the Guard's Summer on Stage Experience, the Passport to Literacy program, and the School Time series, supported by local business sponsors, brings professional productions to busloads of kids. And young people always bring an important voice to the Guard stage.
I'm totally amazed at the talent contest. You're talking 250 people. The production is unbelievable because they put one person right after the next, and that has to do with, you know, interaction with the community. It's really diverse.
The theater, with its wonderful facility, has also been developing plans to become a regional arts magnet.
We're working with the city and the state in helping New London become the first city in the state, and maybe one of the few in the country, to have an entire school district that is a regional magnet school system.
The Guard Theater is a valued community destination and a cultural getaway.
There's an energy. You walk in here and you become a part of an energy of the hundreds of thousands of people that have been here.
And they see a city alive. They see a city that has visitors and residents mingling.
The Guard Arts Center brings together new ideas and new communities, making it a Connecticut cultural treasure. To really appreciate art, well, it begins with the art of watching.
What do you actually see? What are your eyes telling you?
I want all eyes right here on this painting.
A big part of what we're interested in doing, and a number of our educators have really pioneered this in some of the courses and tours we give, is to slow down and say, we're just going to spend a half hour, an hour on this one painting.
What do you see? Yes, you in the back.
And whether a work of art seems realistic or appears magical, is puzzling or provocative, a certain painting or object just speaks to us.
All of us have a sense of personal identity, whether it's our cultural background or family. Many people come here to find mirrors of where they came from. But on another level, great works of art operate on a plane much beyond that. They're universal.
Here in New Haven, at the Yale University Art Gallery, the entire universe is pretty much open to you. The nation's very first art museum is always free and accessible to everyone.
Since you can come back and forth as often and for as short or as long as you like, you can stop in front of two works or three or five and just lose yourself.
Founded in 1832, when Patriot artist John Trumbull donated more than 100 works, the museum is now housed in three architecturally unique, interconnected buildings, thanks to a recently completed multi-year $135 million makeover and expansion.
A great blessing for the gallery is that we were at last able to, in a sense, recapture three of the most important buildings that represent the gallery's entire life. All three of those buildings, which in themselves are great artworks of architecture, each representing a crucial period of cultural development in America.
And while most university art galleries offer small representational samplings, the Yale Gallery, with over 200,000 works amassed within 11 curatorial areas, is one of the great museums in America.
This is an encyclopedic museum. We have something of everything, but there are at least four collections here which are world famous. Those include our early Italian paintings, our American paintings and decorative arts, our 20th century collection, which is perhaps rivaled only by the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and our Indo-Pacific collections. A visitor here, for example, might be surprised to see possibly Van Gogh's greatest painting, his Night Cafe. One of the great masterpieces by Manet, Antonio Polaiolo's Rape of Deianira. In the American collections, the greatest hits of each of the greatest American painters.
With a name that's synonymous with great knowledge, research, and teaching, the Yale Gallery's mission is deeply focused on opportunities for unique learning and growth.
Everything we do involves students. Where in the exhibition, many things placed here and there, the collection of Dorothy and Herbert Vogel. They immerse themselves in the collection. They get to know the works of art inside out. They're involved in curating exhibitions.
And at this preeminent training ground for museum professionals, artistic objects become the tools for communication.
The gallery has over 10,000 K-12 students visit in a given year. With our Wordle Gallery Teacher Program, the vast majority of those students are taught by Yale graduate students. It's really a once-in-a-lifetime experience.
What is this very self-confident black woman doing here? She's turned away from her easel, and yet she's been painting her own self-portrait, but it's a paint-by-the-numbers painting.
Under the leadership of director Jock Reynolds, today's groundbreaking artists also become part of the gallery's active educational mission.
Another thing we do is bring living artists to spend time and to do research and work and talk amongst our students.
Recently, artist Red Grooms was the focus of a special exhibition of his popular large-scale work.
I love the way Red shows ourselves to ourselves. He, in many ways, puts up a mirror.
Red Grooms is just one example of the gallery's many unique exhibitions, programs, and special performances that open doors to conversations motivated by creative work.
It's seeing the light bulb go off in the eyes of one person at a time. Then you know that it was all worth it.
In a time when the trends say that speed and quantity of information makes us wiser, faster, just maybe slowing down to watch and wonder provides us what we're really searching for.
Once you get by the surface, you realize these aren't just mute documents of history. They're living, vital creations. That's what a museum like this is really meant to be sharing with the world.
Prudence Crandall, who opened an academy for young African-American women in the 1830s, is Connecticut state heroine. But there's a lot about her life that people don't know. She and her students faced harassment and violence to become a pivotal fixture in the national abolitionist movement.
As we're walking up the stairs, remember that these are original.
Some Canterbury students are learning about the drama of her story.
I think especially when the museum first opened, that the storyline was looked at very simplistically. She was seen as this calm, Quaker, quiet woman. It was not that at all. She was someone who came at the controversy fully well knowing what she was to face.
She was a woman who had a lot of inner strength, a lot of moral courage.
She actually fought very hard for her school and got to teach who she wanted to.
After opening the school in downtown Canterbury and completing 1 year with a roster of white students, Prudence was approached by the 19-year-old African-American Sarah Harris. Harris was a friend of Crandall's maid.
Sarah had access to the building. While here, she could hear the girls discussing, learning, having their classes.
Sarah Harris really, really wanted to teach. And to be able to teach, what do you have to do now? If you want to be a teacher, you have to do what?
Go to college and get a degree.
Right. And this was the highest level of education that she could get.
Prudence read the Liberator paper. She knows the anti-slavery movement. She knows the injustice that African Americans are living every day. With Sarah coming to her requesting an education, she sees that as her way of providing and assisting in the cause one-on-one.
The result was drastic. The community turned against Prudence. Facing dwindling resources, growing local hostility, and an increasing amount of media attention, Prudence formulated a new plan. She reopened the school as an academy for young women of color.
Eventually, the student body includes girls coming from Boston, Providence, New Haven, New York City, as far away as Philadelphia. Now, these are African-American young women that are coming from upper-middle-class black families who, in some cases, could have provided a similar level of education within their own communities. These families were doing that because they knew it would become a court case. They knew this would eventually end up in the courts.
And it did. The state passed a law aimed specifically at Crandall, prohibiting African Americans from entering Connecticut for the purpose of getting an education. Prudence was tied up in lawsuits for months. Although the academy had supporters, they were out of state and abroad. The local community, including her neighbor Andrew Judson, continued to make life incredibly difficult for Prudence and her students.
Once the state of Connecticut passed what was called the Black Law, which in essence makes it illegal for Prudence to operate the academy, though she continues, the harassment, the violence escalates to a point where there is an attempt to set the building on fire.
Someone probably put their hand outside underneath the rocks in the foundation with some scraps of wood and some leaves and set fire to it that way.
Fortunately, the blaze never really takes, but it's this constant increasing level of harassment, violence.
Despite the daily harassment, Prudence and her students continued on with their educations and their lives. Amidst the ongoing challenges, Sarah Harris got married and became pregnant with her first child.
September 9th, Sarah Harris's baby is born in the morning. Everybody's all excited. And that night, they surround the school and they have the riot and they smash all the windows.
It makes me sad that the people of Canterbury acted this way.
Fearing for their safety, Prudence was forced to close the school permanently.
Once the academy closed, the house was sold, and then it stayed in private ownership until the state of Connecticut bought the house in 1969. We were really lucky that the state of Connecticut stepped in and bought the building. I think they may have bought it for different reasons in the 60s. It was a matter of the beginnings of black history, looking at research, just the very beginnings of women's history. But the storyline is so much bigger than that.
It's cool that something important happened in Canterbury, where I live.
The Yale Peabody Museum of Natural History in New Haven, Connecticut has a long and fascinating history. The visitor experience begins outside on the lawn with a stroll through a garden composed of rare plants and tree specimens, a Cretaceous landscape from 70 million years ago. A trackway of mysterious three-toed dinosaur footprints leads to the life-size bronze sculpture by Michael Anderson of a Torosaurus, first named by Peabody scientist O.C. Marsh. Here, art and imagination dramatize a world no humans have ever seen. The fields of science and medicine were just emerging at the turn of the 19th century when Yale hired its first professor of science, Benjamin Silliman. Minerals and rocks were Professor Silliman's focus. One in particular, the Western meteorite, made him famous.
The first recorded meteorite fall and recovery in the New World occurred in 1807, and it was recovered from Weston, Connecticut. And one of Silliman's more famous scientific contributions was the actual study of that particular meteorite. And it was Silliman's mineral collection that really formed the foundation of the Peabody collection that we see today.
A half a century later, budding paleontologist O.C. Marsh persuaded his uncle George Peabody, who had built his fortune in London by specializing in stocks and investments in an expanding America, to build Yale College, a museum of natural history.
The Great Hall of Dinosaurs was designed to house O.C. Marsh's historic collection of dinosaurs and other fossil vertebrates. And it's dominated by the 80-foot skeleton of the Brontosaurus. Today, we know that the name Brontosaurus is no longer used by scientists. We use the name Apatosaurus for that particular skeleton. But that was the skeleton that put essentially the Peabody on the map. And it is the only place in the world where you can see an actual skeleton of quote-unquote Brontosaurus.
In 1942, the museum's director hired Rudolf Zallinger, then a senior in the Yale School of Fine Arts, to paint The Age of Reptiles, a 110-foot-long mural for the Great Hall of Dinosaurs that took 5 years to complete. This colorful, imaginary landscape is the world's largest natural history mural. It shows 300 million years of plant and animal evolution.
When the mural was completed in the late 1940s, it then became very popular and very famous. And in fact, Life magazine used the image of the study for the mural in their The World We Live In series.
Zallinger then created a second mural, The Age of Mammals, for the Hall of Mammalian Evolution.
So the mastodon you can see on display was first discovered in 1872 on a farm west of the Hudson River. And it's pretty phenomenal to think that as recent as 10,000 years ago, giant sloths, saber-toothed cats, and elephants like this mastodon were roaming North America. Near the mastodon is our ground sloth skeleton. And what's particularly exciting about that skeleton is the fact that it has preserved skin and actually hair is still part of the skeleton.
The Peabody Museum is famous for its dioramas, including several on the plant and animal ecology of Connecticut. The exceptionally talented team of James Perry Wilson and Ralph Morrill created scenes of astonishing realism.
One of the dioramas on the third floor is the Connecticut Shoreline Diorama, and it's one of the most spectacular dioramas we feature. And it features the shore, the marsh, and an adjacent farm. And the artistry of that particular mural, the mixture of art and science to produce that, is really phenomenal and is really a landmark in diorama creation.
Wilson and Morrill's Forest Margin presents a mid-October day in Cornwall Hollow, Litchfield County. It is a kaleidoscope of color as shorter days and diminished sunlight change the chemistry of leaves, all captured with breathtaking fidelity.
In the Gallery of Human Evolution, we trace our own human story, starting about 7 million years ago with the very first hominins that evolved in Africa, all the way up through Homo erectus, the Neanderthals, and all of the other members of our family to the present day in our species Homo sapiens.
The very popular Hall of Ancient Egypt features a reconstructed tomb.
And within the tomb, visitors can see an actual sarcophagus which contained the actual mummy that Peabody still has in its collections.
The Hall of Connecticut Birds includes more than 300 of the 382 documented species living in our state. What is displayed at the Peabody Museum is a small portion of its vast collections. Storage areas bulging with fascination await scholars and future displays.
Our collections total 13 million specimens and always growing. The collections of natural history museums truly form the foundation of our understanding of the natural world, and collections like those at the Peabody are an important part of that foundation.
The Yale Peabody Museum of Natural History is an internationally significant repository of natural and human history. The experience of rare fascination at this museum brings us closer to nature, closer to the prehistoric world, and closer to aspects of our own distinct Connecticut environment.
They are stories of romance and danger, risks and successes. The history of aviation, told at the New England Air Museum, is a testament to achieving what had once seemed impossible.
Ignition, liftoff.
And much of that history happened right here in the museum's home state of Connecticut.
Can you imagine someone just a few years after the Wright brothers flew, built his first plane, and lived through the aviation era to see man walk on the moon? My father is Igor Sikorsky, the aviation pioneer. Here in Connecticut, he achieved, I think, his greatest successes. From the very beginning, in his childhood, his mother showed him Leonardo da Vinci had a sketch showing what looked very much like a helicopter. When he saw that, instinctively, he knew that that was his destiny.
Sikorsky started his pioneering aviation work in his native Russia. When the revolution broke out, he fled to America and eventually settled in Stratford, Connecticut. In the 1930s, he built amphibian airplanes like this one, flying boats with enough power to cross oceans, but much too large to land at the airfields of the day.
This airplane would take off from LaGuardia Airport in the East River at the Marine Air Terminal and fly to Europe, to Ireland, where it would land in the Shannon River. It's the last of its kind in the world. It was the ultimate in luxurious travel.
These were important stepping stones toward the ultimate passenger travel, which we now take for granted. He then returned to his original dream, which was to build a functional and successful helicopter. My father was very, very pleased because even in his lifetime, over 1 million people had owed their lives to rescue missions from a helicopter. And that was one of his great prides.
Igor Sikorsky's is just one of the great aviation stories on display here at the New England Air Museum.
The New England Air Museum happens to be the largest aviation museum in New England and also probably in the Northeast. Many of the aircraft that you see here are aircraft you can't see anyplace else. Either they're scarce, rare, or in many cases, unique. The first thing that you'll see is the oldest surviving aircraft in the United States. It's right here. It's a balloon basket that dates from 1870, flown by a Connecticut guy. When you take a look at some of the older aircraft and you really see how they're made, they're fairly fragile. A lot of them are just covered with fabric. There are a lot of open cockpit airplanes. And I think you gain an appreciation for sort of how intrepid some of these early aviators were flying an aircraft like this. People, first of all, are amazed at the size of the facility. But secondly, I think we've really earned a great reputation in the past few years for being a visitor-friendly place.
I wish they had this when I was a kid.
We have tour guides that actually show you around, and they'll get you into a cockpit too, or they bring the museum alive. We have educators that work with the little guys, and they will do a hands-on activity, and then they'll open up a cockpit. And then we can, you know, serve the older generation by actually showing them the aircraft they flew in or showing them the aircraft that their grandfathers flew in. So there's a personal connection. So we really try to, you know, make everybody happy that comes through the door and make their experience, you know, special. This is our newest exhibit. It's our flight sim spot. It's really special and unique. You actually can pick a station and pick the aircraft you want to fly and where you want to fly into. And it does teach you how to fly. It's the basic principles of flight.
You can know nothing about flying an airplane. When we're done with you, you're pretty close to being a full-fledged pilot of sorts. Here at the museum, you can more than just read about it. You can actually talk to the people who helped to make that history.
I just guessed that I could fly a helicopter when I was a kid, and I was afraid to tell anyone because I thought that they would make fun of me.
We really want to keep history alive. That's our big passion. That's history. That's us. That's America.
Mojave Ground, X-ray 1, ready to check taxi to 1-2.
Thanks again for letting us share our state's treasures with each of you. Until our next visit, I'm Edward Zbicki for Connecticut's Cultural Treasures.
funding for Connecticut's cultural treasures is provided by CPTV, Connecticut Tourism, the State Historic Preservation Office of the DECD, Melinda and Paul Sullivan, People's United Bank, What Know-How Can Do.